Hey, kiddies, it's time to get real close to your speakers. Turn them up all the way and sit the fuck down and listen up.
Hey, everyone, welcome to the show. Now prepare to get your ear fucked. Hey, Colonel, what the fuck are you doing, brother? Here's your host, Mr. Colonel, with his special guest, Mr. And Lou.
Gentlemen, this is Mr. And Lou. I am filling in for the infamous Mr. the Colonel.
Hey, where's your monkey, Mr. And Lou?
Yeah, I don't know where my monkey is, Mr. Mighty Mouth. He is gone for now. So, at any rate, we're going to still have all kinds of fun tonight because I got all kinds of random music for you. And that's the important thing. You get some random music and we listen to something and then criticize it. So, at any rate, y'all stick around. Let's get into this. Up first, I love this background music. I just want to let it play. This is great. I gotta play that intro more often. That's a great intro. Okay, up first we got Dev Avedon, and as the game goes, we pull randomly from the stack. Maybe it'll be good. Maybe it'll be something we can poke fun at for long periods of time. Oh, there's somebody on the phone. Let's see who's on the line. You are live on Music Machete. Who we got on the line?
This is Gage Maverick calling you from Hollywood, California, on set.
Hey, Jay, how's it going?
No, Gage Maverick.
Oh, Gage. Gage. Okay, hey, Gage, how you doing, man?
I'm doing wonderful. How are you doing today?
Real good, real good. Wow, we didn't even get our number out there, and you called in. That's great. Hey, what you calling in about, Gage?
Well, anything you want to talk about, Troy sent me over, Mr. Madman Troy, so told me to call in as soon as I had a free moment today. And I tried to get you by 5, but I was on set shooting and rolling, as you know, in beautiful business of TV magic making.
Hey, all right. Okay, well, tell us what you're working on, Gage. Why not? Let's go down that line. Tell us what you're working on. What film are you working on?
Let's do it. I'm actually working on a television show. It's a second appearance I'm making on a TV show that's actually on Investigation Discovery called Blood Relatives. It's in its third season. We're shooting season 3 right now, and I'm on an episode at a studio in Hollywood, and we're shooting it as we speak. I'm just on a bit of a break right now.
Very cool. Very cool. Right on. And what do you do for them?
Well, in this particular role, I'm playing a uniformed police officer. The show is a crime reenactment about family-on-family crime. So the show title is actually a double entendre, Blood Relatives, right? So Blood Relatives. You know, it's like a husband killed the wife, or the kid killed the parents, or the brother killed the brother, or a sibling killed a sibling, or a cousin killed a cousin, whatever. And it's true stories, and they're reenacting them and showing them for people to see.
Oh, wow. That is a crazy show. I don't know if I'd want to watch that
show.
Because that sounds, I don't know, that's maybe too scary for me. I don't like
that. That's not as scary as much as it is more educational, teaching, you know, these things probably shouldn't happen. So you're informing people a little bit about, you know, that it's kind of sad that it does happen, but kind of bringing the stories to light would, you know, make people watch it and go, gosh, man, maybe I should work out my differences with my family, right?
Yeah, well what do they do in the way of, I mean, they're showing this program. Are they investigating the situation, recreating it, and figuring out what went wrong, or like...
Yes, it's all of that. It's a recreation. So what they do is they have whoever the survivors are, or if there's an attorney involved, if there's police officers involved, or detectives, the real people that are still around are actually telling the story on screen, and then they go back into the flashbacks, and we play the flashbacks of the events leading up to the crime, and then after that, like if there was foul play involved, the investigators will then talk about that, and they go, well, I suspected it all along. You know, I knew that, you know, she was lying about this, or she was lying about that, you know, whatever, and you see the people telling the story after the fact, kind of going into remembrance mode as they tell it, and then you see us on screen as actors playing it out, and they cast lookalikes for all the various personnel that's involved with the story. Like, I look like the cop that was investigating the scene. And last episode I was on, I looked like the lead investigator, and I played the guy that kind of cracks the whole crime and whatnot.
So you look like a lot of different people in the world then. Is that how you keep getting the gig?
I do, yeah, because I have to take on many different looks. I'm not more of a chameleon, I would say. I have very many different looks to myself.
No, I know people like that. I had a friend back in the day that had a boyfriend who every time he would show up, I'd be like, "Who's that guy?" Well, you know Dave. And I'm like, "That's Dave?" Oh, for some reason I had a different look in my head. And then I would see him like, 2 weeks later. And then I would be like, "Who's that guy?" "That's Dave."
Right.
"Really?"
Yeah. So Dave may have had like a different color hair, different hairstyle, or he may have been clean shaven one day and then had a full beard the next time he saw him.
Oh yeah, he was always dyeing his hair a different color, and cutting it differently, and then totally changing out the way he dressed. And
right. So,
I mean, you never knew. I could never recognize the guy. I mean, if I had spent enough time with him, I'm sure I could have. But he could have come into our cafe like 20 times in a row, and I still wouldn't have figured out who he was, you know.
Well, I'll tell you, what was kind of cool about it is if you Google Gage Maverick, take the C out of Maverick, G-A-G-E-M-A-V-E-R-I-K, you'll see all the different looks that I've taken on. There's lots of images, and you Google image search of me, and I'm kind of the same way. I don't dye my hair as much, but I'll change looks. I'll do like kind of scruffy kind of look to the clean-shaven kind of look, and then I've got this cool like sideburns, half a tee kind of thing that I rock a lot of times. So I'm always kind of changing it up and trying to keep people on their toes.
So you got a website out there, Gage?
Yes, you can go to youtube.com/TheGageMaverick, TheGageMaverick. Again, no C in Maverick. Or you can check me out on Vimeo at vimeo.com/channels/GageTV.
So,
and then I'm all over Facebook and Twitter the same ways.
Awesome. So tell me, what other projects besides this one have you been involved with?
What a great question. I appreciate you bringing that up. I've done a whole lot of MC work and hosting work. I recently MC'd the Los Angeles Music Awards nomination show, and the actual LA Music Awards show will be coming up on November the 14th at the Avalon. That's presented by Mr. Al Bowman, who has worked his whole life at giving independent artists exposure in the music scene. So mad props to Al Bowman, and I wish him much success on that show.
Yeah, I went to that last year. I went to that nomination show last year.
Okay.
And one of our really good friends, friend of the station, Stevie Hawkins, actually won a couple awards there last year. So for like blues singer or something like that. I can't remember exactly what all, but man.
Right, they have many categories for different types of artists, different genres and whatnot. So
yeah.
I emceed that. He turned the reins over to myself for a little while, and that was a lot of fun. In addition to that, I have multiple of my own projects that I'm working on trying to get distribution funding for, or trying to get networks to pick up and air and all of that. That's kind of part of my daily grind, is trying to get some of my own projects on the air.
Sure, yeah. So I want to talk more about the Independent Music Awards and your involvement with that. Now, those guys that you're getting, all independent musicians, we're an all independent station, so we only play independent musicians. You should totally send as many of those guys our way as you can, because, you know, that's what we do. That's our gig. That's our bad.
Well, I'll tell you, there's a nice little collaboration here then, because I've actually created a television show where I give a television platform for artists just like the ones you're playing on the air. So we should work together on maybe a nice little collaboration to take the artists you're playing on the air and then give them a television platform so that people can actually see them perform live and then get interviewed by myself on the air. The television show is called The Gage Maverick Road Show, and it's all about independent artists. Now, most of it is musicians. We also throw in dance acts, and we throw in magic, and we throw in comedy. So it's a traveling variety show looking to discover undiscovered original talent in every area of the entertainment business. And you can Google that as well. It's also on Facebook at facebook.com/TheGageMaverickRoadShow. And again, it's no C in Maverick, M-A-V-E-R-I-K. Roadshow, the Gage Maverick Roadshow.
I can't wait to check that out.
I'm a big fan of what you're doing, and I would love to work something out with you guys, and hopefully we can, you know, cover all angles for these artists that you're giving airplay for on your radio station. I'd love to let them be seen by billions of people worldwide on TV.
Yeah, definitely, for sure. Yeah, you know, that's what it's about. You know, we've been here doing this. All the hosts are volunteers, and we just do it because we love the music. And you know, when I got involved in it, you know, I was amazed at how much great music is out there that's completely undiscovered. People just don't know them, you know. And it's my mission to get that music out there, you know. Be it, you know, maybe even the band is dead. I like playing music from dead bands because they were never discovered. Nobody's heard it yet still, you know.
That's right. I'll tell you what, I'm going to expand upon that because I have a profound and deep respect for people that can do things I cannot, and that's things like write and compose music and play instruments beautifully and have, you know, deep meaning lyrics and you know, have deep-rooted underlying meaning to and telling stories through music and also through comedy and through, you know, presentation of magic acts and so on and so forth. So that's why I created the show that I created, because I think I'm a pretty good host. So I combined what I do the best with the things that I love the most, because I'm always about going and seeing live performances. I mean, if you and I were walking down the street and we saw someone over there tap dancing on the side of the street for money, I'm probably going to go over and watch them for a little bit, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm the same way.
I love watching people do their own. I'm drawn to people performing live. I go to comedy shows on a weekly basis. I see sketch comedy and I see improv comedy. I go to IO West right there. I'm going to give them a shout out. IO West right over there at Hollywood and Cosmo, excuse me, and every Friday night I see the opening night, the musical, and it's the most unbelievable thing ever. They create a musical right in front of your face that you give a suggestion about, and they perform it right in front of you, and they sing songs, and they do comedy, and it's perfectly wonderful, and they make up songs right then and there on the spot.
That sounds like so much fun. I want to go do that. That sounds like so much fun. Yeah, you know, I used to live in Pacific Palisades, which is right next to Santa Monica, and I used to spend so much time going down to the promenade and to Venice Beach just to watch people, you know, do whatever they were doing, you know, dancing or, you know, juggling or playing their music, you know. And it's amazing, especially on the promenade in Santa Monica. There is a lot of amazing talent out there.
Absolutely, and sometimes there'll be a little setup at City Walk and Universal. There'll be someone out there playing beautiful music, and then at the front of it, you got this guy down there like telling jokes, and he's performing. He's a one-man show. It's really everywhere, and so I what it does though for me is it continues to validate the need for the television show that we just talked about that I've created, and your radio show that you have. So we should really talk a little bit further about that off air.
Yeah, we should. I would love to get out there on the street and really spend time with performers that are performing on the street and recording them on the street and then putting that together, because I think that that's almost more amazing, because you get to see the crowd interaction or the lack thereof to what's amazing music. One time they had this, you know, world famous violin player in New York come and play Carnegie Hall, I believe it was, and then like the next day he went in the subway and played in the subway just like wearing normal clothes, and everybody walked past him like he was nothing.
Yeah, like he didn't exist. He was like a very established concert violinist.
Right, and it's like the night before, people were paying like $75 to see him, a ticket, you know.
Right.
And it's like people don't know.
They don't know.
They don't get it.
And they don't appreciate it.
Yeah, you have to set it up for them. You have to go, look at this, and then they get appreciation. For you know, if you're just walking by, people just don't, you know. But at any rate, I love that. That's great.
Like American Idol or X Factor or any of those America's Got Talent, they thrive because you got a guy that's a billionaire that can, you know, produce a show like that and then put it on the air. Whereas someone like myself, who's just a little man on the totem pole, comes up with a great idea. In my opinion, And it sounds like you kind of think the same, you know, in regard to my television show, but to try and get in front of the right people has always been the challenge, and get it backed by someone that has vision, that's also been the challenge. If we can make that show work, we can change a lot of people's lives, and we can give a lot of people exposure that don't necessarily get it right now today.
Yeah. And you know, that's the thing. That's why we keep pushing this radio station. That, you know, this radio station has been on the air for over 10 years. We have over 10 years of collected musicians of music, of just random musicians from all over the place, all over the world. And we have over a decade of that music. And it's that's an amazing thing, you know. And, you know, as our listenership goes up, it's really exciting to see that opportunity for those people to get heard. People that, you know, maybe the biggest place they ever played, you know, held 100 or 150 people, and now they're being broadcast out to several thousand. So
I love it. And if anyone's listening here today and wants to get behind something like this, get in touch with us, and let's collaborate on something beautiful.
Always. All right, so we're about to go into we got some time. Let me ask you, are there any other projects that you have worked on or that you're working on that you wanted to talk about?
I have a whole lot of them. I can't talk about the rest of them because some of them are sort of below the radar until I can get them in front of the right people. Suffice it to say, I've got several of them that are episodic television shows, and that some of them are designed to just merely entertain. Some of them are designed to actually positively affect people's lives, and some of them are designed to, you know, give exposure to people that don't have it or whatnot, or just to also kind of revolutionize the way people kind of look at television.
Right. Because television is changing. You see a lot more reality shows. How do you feel about reality shows? Do you feel that they are a positive thing, or do you think that that's kind of, we're getting into just cheaper, junkier television series?
That's a great question, and I believe that what's happening with the advent of reality shows is twofold. It's you know, from a network executive standpoint, they see it as cheap television where they're going to get advertisers and viewers. And so that's the case. It's a big bang for the buck, right? It's like an easy product to put out there. It doesn't cost very much, and they're going to get a lot of people to watch it because they're train wrecks. Now, the second part of that, which I think is completely negative, is it's a deterioration in intelligence level. So what happens is people start watching smut like, you know, Real Wives of Beverly Hills or whatever, or Orange County or Jersey Shore, and you watch a bunch of idiots go out and get in bar fights all the time, and that's your source of entertainment. Well, what about something that has merit when you're looking at people that are making beautiful art? Or you're looking at people that have amazing performance skills? Or you're looking at people that are, you know, in actual need of something to help themselves, like a show like Extreme Makeover. You know, when they were fixing people's houses that were in need, that show got pulled off of the air, you know, and it's like, okay, yes, but, you know, all these other shows are continuing to run, and it's kind of like smut TV at its finest, but it's a sad testimonial to what people are buying into when a show that's about dumpster diving has more longevity, or a show that's about an antique road show that's been around forever, and you can't keep a show on the air that actually does good things for people, or you can't get shows on the air that are designed to positively affect the lives of people that are desperately in need for it.
Right. You know, and I see this all the time. People have these great project ideas, and the only thing that doesn't make them viable is the reality of the monetary system. And like, oh, well, is that going to make us enough money? You know, even if it's helpful to people, you know, maybe people, it's too smart, or it's too, you know what I mean? And it's like, they have this thing where I feel like they're trying to dumb down the audience, the nation in general.
You said it better than me. That's exactly right. I flirted with the lack of intelligence, but you're right. Dumbing down to the audience, because it's also an ADD world, which is a transition to what I think is the next phase, and that's the internet and doing things, web series and web TV and things like that, which I'm very, very open to on the projects that I'm interested in having, you know, some help getting funded, because, you know, the internet's the wild frontier. We can do whatever we want. And you know, drive viewership ourselves.
Exactly. And I think that that is, I think that that is where everything's heading. I think with the, like with the music industry, you know, you've had a lot of musicians use the internet to, they kind of just went, you know, forget the, you know, label, the record label. We don't need it. We're going to just, you know, we're just going to go. Hey, do you want to hang on? We got to go to a commercial break. Do you want to hang on real quick and we'll
absolutely
come back?
Absolutely, go ahead.
All right, we'll be right back.
Get your pussy today. Takes pussy to get pussy. Remember, kids, be careful with a wet pussy. They can get angry. Don't be shy. Get your pussy today. You know it takes pussy to get pussy. Remember, kids, be careful with a wet pussy. They can get angry.
Ever wonder how you can extend the life of your garden and keep it pest-free for months? Or learn the secret experts have known for years? From novice to expert, the Grow Light can handle all of your garden supply needs and carry only the best brands to help you grow your garden you've always dreamed of. Visit us at thegrowlight.com today. Yeah, thegrowlight.com. Gardening supplies and accessories.
Are you looking for professional search engine optimization for you and your business? Look no further. Announcing Keyword Search Pros. KSP has been optimizing sites for years and knows how to increase your website's visibility and ranking. Their expert team will take you step by step and get the best possible results within your budget. And the outcome is always more visitors and increased traffic. Stop by their website and sign up for a free Google AdWords evaluation. For complete information on search engine optimization and pay-per-click management, visit KeywordSearchPros.com.
Do you have trouble seeding and maintaining your lawn? Well, that's too bad. Looks like you should move, you lazy asshole.
Get off my lawn.
And we're back here on Music Machete. And we are talking to Gage Maverick. And we're just discussing the music industry and the movie industry and kind of the dumbing down of our nation. You know, this show is actually really all about bringing random music on and basically pointing out what's wrong with it. And we get a lot of really stupid music. I mean, we get a lot of great music, don't get me wrong. But literally, some of the stuff that we get is so bad. And people release it. And here's one of the things that I found on the internet that I think is kind of a drawback, is a lot of artists are going and releasing stuff that really should be like a scratch pad. That's where you started, and you haven't finished the project yet. And I see that kind of thing going on, especially in the beginning with YouTube. Now you have YouTube flooded with a lot of professional stuff that looks really good. But in the beginning, it was very, like, people would just put up random crap. And it's like, how do you wade through all of that to find, like, the really good stuff? That's, like, one of my things with YouTube about, like, trying to find stuff. But how do you get that impression? How do you feel about that general, like, now I can put anything up, now I'm just going to put everything up?
Yeah, it's a really good question, and it's a good observation, actually, Machete, what do you do if, you know, you've got an open forum to express yourself, to put your performance out there, to, you know, maybe have the opportunity of being searched and found, but on top of that, or in addition to that, what's happening is you're saturating that same process at the same time, so it's kind of a catch-22, I think. But I think what's happened is when you have companies like Vivo that kind of actually qualify and have, you know, conversations with the artists about, you know, their followership and their, you know, types of music and things like that, I think you're starting to see kind of some tiers that are kind of being created.
Mm-hmm.
It allows for, you know, a better quality, maybe music video, a better quality song, or a better quality act that's going to have the opportunity of having their stuff in a better place on YouTube, so to speak. So you can put the Vivo in and add that to your search. So if you're not a Vivo artist, then it doesn't come up. Does that make sense?
Interesting. I'd never heard that before. Vivo. What is Vivo?
So, No, Vivo.
Vivo.
V-E-V-O.
Sorry.
V as in Victor, yes.
Okay.
And you'll see it. You look at certain artists, they're a Vivo artist, and it'll have, it's got the nice little framing around the music video on there, and as it launches, obviously you got the commercial and the advertisement, but it's like a sponsored by or almost like a distributed by Vivo in YouTube itself.
Hmm. And are they a YouTube-only affiliated company, or what is, or is that a part of YouTube?
I believe so. I believe so. They're almost like the YouTube label, if you will.
I see. I see. Yeah, okay.
Check it out. You can look it up. You can look it up like Linkin Park and Incubus and all the qualified bands. When you look at their music video, you'll see the Vivo come up with it. Now, I believe they're affiliated. I can't remember officially, but they might be in some way affiliated with like a Sony or a Universal or something like that.
I see. Yeah. I still feel like that sounds to me like even though they're qualifying people, they're really just qualifying the talented people. I mean, if they're a Sony affiliated, then it's just
maybe
just the ones that they consider talented, not everybody who actually has talent. So sellable bands.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, but you want to do that. You want to be able to separate that from the observation you just made about people putting horrible music up and us having to sift through it. You need to have some way of kind of sifting through to find the gold. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. But I feel like that stuff, we're going to hear it. It's going to come out because you're associated with Sony or whatever. I guess what I'm saying is there's also a lot of undiscovered music that's really great, that's at that high of quality, that maybe the artist isn't sellable, you know? They aren't good looking enough, I guess that's what we're talking about.
There's really a lot to it. It's really hard. It's kind of like trying to find, it's like a comedian trying to find their formula for the perfect comedy act if he or she has only been in front of 10 audiences. It takes a while to find out what that formula is that works. So you got to try the same thing in front of 30 audiences or 50 audiences or 100 audiences so that you have more of a better litmus test to see what's going to hit and what's going to be your go-to and your solid act and your solid performance. So I think music is the same. You just, there's so many variables, you know. And also, too, it's relative to the listener. You know, what you think is crap, others may think is good. And that's unfortunate, but it's a reality.
Right, right. Yeah,
and I guess who decides?
Yeah, and I guess that's the thing with like people like Sony. I feel like, I mean, whoever picks out the American, I never like the American Idol people. Like whoever picks out those singers and those songs, I never like any of that. Like what's considered popular, 9 times out of 10, I'm not gonna like it. You know.
Right. Well, the thing is, with the American Idol people, all that stuff is pre-selected.
Right.
That stuff is all orchestrated ahead of time. You know, the American public watches it and go, "Oh, that's great! That's one! I can't believe it!" When that person was supposed to win all along. Like
yeah.
They manipulate everything. Because think about it: you don't know exactly how the voting is. You don't actually sit in the office and see them tallying up the votes. You know, and deciding. That stuff is all done by the production company. They all know who's going to be first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh. They know.
Yeah.
Why? Because they already have contracts in place with the top three, and they're gonna get as much as 28% of their income and their earnings and their appearance fees and their albums and their songs for the next 3 to 5 years.
Wow, I did not know that. I didn't know that they had that much, that big of a lock on it, on their whole career.
Oh, absolutely own you. And that's why some people like, well, look at the American Idol contract that have been chosen to go through, and they will decline it. And that's another thing that gives validation to a show like mine, because they would rather perform their own material in front of 8 or 10 people rather than going and singing someone else's music in front of billions of people worldwide. And the true artist considers that a sellout.
Yeah. And see,
we want true artists, just like you want true artists on your show, that want to perform their own original music in front of people that will appreciate that.
Yeah, and I think that's my thing. What it really comes down to is that it's all about, if it's not an original song, you're not that great. If you didn't write it, okay, there's so many people that can sing, and there's so many people that have a great voice, and I mean, I don't mean to be rude, but they're a dime a dozen. If you don't have the full package, if you can't sing, write, you know, compose, play, then really, I mean, I don't mean to be harsh on any of you American Idol fans. Really, you're not a musician. And I know that people think, oh, but he's a singer, so he's a musician. Well, And he's then so is a dancer. You know, those are things that we kind of, you know, you have that innately inside of you, and you can learn to improve on it, and you can learn some tricks, but it's not like sitting down and studying the guitar or studying music theory, unless that person has. And I'm not talking about every singer, obviously, but that's what I get the impression of. Go ahead. I was just going to say, that's the impression that I get from the American Idol artists, is that those are the type of artists that haven't studied music theory. You know,
let me validate that with you, and I'm just going to expand upon what you're saying. I'm going to agree with you, and I'm going to take it a step further and also validate it. So take a look at the last 10 American Idol winners. How many of them are actually selling albums, doing concerts, and continuing their craft? About 2% of them.
Yeah.
Kelly Clarkson, Carrie Underwood, Daughtry, even that Adam Lambert guy has had one, maybe two hits. Right?
Yeah.
So out of all, like, the worst one was that Taylor Hicks. He did nothing. Did a Ford commercial. And then did a road trip in a movie, in the musical Grease, where he played teen idol. I mean, horrible. Horrible. So the point being, that point I'm making, is that they don't know. Even the American Idol people, they're pre-producing these winners. They don't know, because look, they're not succeeding, these people.
Yeah.
Right? So the original artists need an open platform for an opportunity to be seen by the world.
Yeah.
Not three judges trying to make a name for themselves.
Exactly. And you know, I think that does shows, I mean, I've seen this, there's a new one now they have where the judges have to sit with their back to the singer.
Yeah, the voice, know. Yeah.
The voice, okay. I think they're getting closer with that. They're getting a little bit better of a go. But at the same time,
well, you're still hearing karaoke. At the end of the day, it's still karaoke. Exactly. They're singing someone else's music.
Exactly. And that's, you know, that's the thing. And yeah, that's it. All those, that's what it is. All those shows are just glorified karaoke.
That's it. 45 seconds of karaoke.
That's so lame. That's so lame.
I say that in pitch meetings, and I'm pitching my stuff to investors, or I'm pitching my stuff to network executives. I use those words in my pitch. That's why the true artists won't do it, because they don't want to do karaoke. You don't see them at karaoke shows every week. You know what I mean? You see people that can't write and compose music at karaoke shows every week. You know, the true artist is formulating, getting back to what you just said. They're writing and composing their songs, and they're taking music theory, and they're, like, you know, really breaking down a guitar and figuring out a new way to play it. Or they're adding a cool ukulele to a rock and roll medley and mixing that up, right? Or they're, you know,
that's what
the true artist is doing, and we need to give them a platform. You're already doing it for radio. I'd like to do it for TV. Yeah. So let's make that work.
I think really the true artist, if you're a real artist, and I don't mean to be bagging on people that just go out and try to make hit records that sound like everything else, but the true artist is really there to discover. They do it because either they haven't seen that done or they haven't heard that done. So they want to see what that would look like on the canvas, or they want to hear what that would sound like through the speakers. That's an artist, you know, and I think a lot of people just miss that completely, you know, about artists, that it's really about creating something new, about creating something different, doing something that at least you yourself have never done, you know, that you've never heard it, you've never seen that done, you know. If you don't have that, you don't have anything. You know, if you don't have that desire to constantly find new things, you want to get famous and have a lot of money and be a rock star. You don't want to be an artist. You don't want to be a musician.
That's true. That's true. There's a big difference between celebrity status and clinging to your true craft and staying true to your art and staying true to your art form while maintaining your own integrity. And I think that's when we say the word original artists, we mean the original artist, not someone that can sound like somebody else and just come to it creatively on a very surface level.
Right. Yeah. And so to you, obviously what you do, you're a very creative person involved in a lot of stuff. To you, what is it that drives your art?
The opportunity to make more of it. because you're only, if for a true creative, and I really do thank you for acknowledging that, and I really do think of myself as that, because my wheels are always turning. My gears are always churning. I'm always thinking of something, some idea, some cool something or other. I just wrote, produced, and directed a cool internet commercial for a client of mine that I started a year ago. I just shot that on Tuesday night. I'm really excited about that. That was a little commercial for a company called Digital Loggers. I want to get that out there, and hopefully maybe he'll tune into this and hear it, appreciate that plug. But you're, to me, as a true creative, you're only as creative as your last project. So you want to continue. So it's almost like, what have you done for me lately? But as a creative, we're always like, as soon as that project is over, we're already in a mindset of moving to the next project. Yeah. And we want to get the next project going. And we want to create the next. It's just like the artist. Now we're talking about the brush artist or the painting artist. Right. You know, they paint one. And a lot of times when you meet these artists, you have a conversation with these artists, the last thing on their mind, I'm talking about, you know, artists that are hanging in galleries, beautiful artists, paintings, okay? Picasso-like, you know, Van Gogh-like, you know, those types of folks. When you meet these people, modern-day artists like that, the last thing on their mind, the last thing, is a monetary gain from those art, those works of art. The last thing.
It's true.
If you ask them, they'll tell you that. They're not doing it because they think it'll be a Rembrandt and sell for $50,000 in some fancy-schmancy house on the hills, right?
Right.
They don't care about that. What they care about is creating something, putting it on a canvas, and hopefully someone will see it and appreciate it. Some of them, if you just go up to them and just kind of look at their work and you appreciate what they say and do, and you literally like have, you know, some emotion in your voice and maybe in your eyes, and you're like, really, that's what they want. The true artist wants to be appreciated for their art form by others. It validates what they do. It validates who they are. It validates where their heart is. It validates where their passion lies.
Yeah,
and that's what it's all about. And when you can do that, and others appreciate you for that, and you get a high five from somebody, sometimes that's better than a check in the mail.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
That's what drives me. Is like when people appreciate what I do, and people like what I do, and they keep casting me and stuff, and they keep bringing me on board for stuff, or they allow me to collaborate with them, you know, and they say, Gabe, let's create something. What do you got? Right? And hopefully if I can just get one or two of my projects going, I'm sorry to keep coming back to it, but if I just get one or two of them going, they'll appreciate that art and appreciate what I'm doing for other people and giving them a platform. Then they'll call me back, and they'll knock on my door again and go, Gabe, okay, well, we got that one going. What's another one? And I'll rip out one of my other products that I've got. I got eight of them, as I mentioned at the very beginning of the call. And if that's the case, then they'll say, Gage, okay, let's talk about the next one. What do you got there?
Right.
And we'll just keep making beautiful projects, and we'll keep affecting people, and we'll keep, like, you know, positively influencing others, and we'll inspire others, we'll motivate people, and we'll do it together. And I can't do it by myself. I'm looking for a team, by the way, that wants to get involved with me. And I've got a group of others that are on board already right now. And start doing that very thing, because as soon as you start doing those types of things, you start creating new ideas. And then you start creatively collaborating with like-minded individuals, and then more ideas come to the front.
Yeah, you know, that's one of the things as a musician, I noticed that I wrote a lot more songs when I surrounded myself with other musicians.
Yeah, because you're inspired by them, and that vibe is right there. That creative vibe is right there.
Exactly.
And you relish that moment, and you go like, and it also challenges you. I got to tell you, and I really want to hear that, but I want to tell you this really quick. I was I sing also, and I was in original cover bands back in Houston, Texas. That's where I'm from, and I sang in cover band. Well, I answered an ad on Craigslist one day for a band looking for a singer, and I don't even write my own music, but they were like, we've got our own music. We're just looking for someone to come in and jam to it. So I went to the audition, and I sang a couple songs that I sing, cover music songs, right? And they said, we want to see what you can come up with. Go write a song and come back and let's put it together. I went and wrote four songs because of it. They challenged me, and I wrote four songs. I didn't know I had the ability to even do that.
Yeah, but it's amazing what you do when you try. When you start doing things, you know, it's like... some of these things are so simple to do, but people don't do them. And I'm not saying that writing a really good song is simple, but writing a song essentially is a pretty simple thing to do. And people don't do it because they never put down that first lyric. They never strum that first chord. They never, you know what I mean? Every journey starts with...
that's a fear that, oh my gosh, you know, they look at that as a hurdle they have to overcome. And then once you just get on the track and you overcome that hurdle, you're good. But some people are afraid to do that. They're afraid to try. They're afraid to reach out. They're afraid to tap into that resource they have. It's a natural resource. I think most people have it. It's about bringing it out. And that's what I love when I'm coaching acting. Excuse me, when I'm talking to my acting students, I try to challenge and stretch them to say, you know, let's really try something different. You know, I actually, in my first consultation with them, I'll say, okay, what's your strength, comedy or drama? And whatever they say it is, I start working with them on the opposite one.
Of course, always.
Because I want to challenge them and I want to stretch them. I want to get them out of their comfort zone.
Right, exactly. And I think that's I wanted to go back to something you said, though, about when you said that you do it because you want somebody to see it one day. You want somebody to hear it. We have an artist here, actually, that this show actually dedicated almost 10, I think it's like 10 shows we dedicated to just his music because he's written so much music. He's a musician named Dixon. And this guy has the worst music that you've ever heard. I mean, like, seriously, I can't explain how bad it is. He just kind of plays guitar randomly over stuff that is randomly put down. So, I mean, it's just, it sounds like it's just thrown into a blender and then served to you. And it's horrible. So we dedicated 10 shows to this guy because, and this is the real reason, well, first of all, it was he had 10 shows worth of material. And don't get me wrong, we probably, with the season ended, we could have kept going. The point was, he's a real artist. And I mean that from my very heart. As much as we've made fun of him on this show and made fun of his music, I've also said time and time again, the guy he doesn't care if you like it or not. He wants somebody to hear it. If one person listens to it and says they like it, he's happy. And he puts out, I swear we must get a submission from him once every week. And he heard the show. He heard us making fun of him for 10 weeks, and he still submits to us. You know? So that's a real artist. And you don't
that's a guy who's driven, and that's a guy who's going to put himself out there regardless of what anyone else says.
Exactly. And that you have to respect. So whenever people, you know, complain about, oh, I don't know, my music is not good enough, or da-da-da-da, I'm always like, dude, well, you're not writing enough. Look at Dixon.
Right.
I mean,
there you go.
You know, when you got somebody that goes out there and puts that shit out over and over and over and over again, and I mean, he improves a little bit. You know, his songs kind of improve, and then sometimes they aren't good again. But the thing is that he constantly puts it out. He just does it. He has to do it. It's just something he has to do. And he has to share it with everybody. It's not something that he can keep.
Now, as you were talking to me, that sounds like maybe that's his therapy.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
You know what that's like? You're an artist.
Oh, yeah.
So that's your therapy, right? You put it out there, and that you kind of sort of, you know, you what's the word I'm looking for? You not purge yourself, but you sort of cleanse yourself.
Yeah, you cleanse yourself.
You that was your therapy. You had to get it off your chest, so to speak, and maybe that's his therapy. Maybe that's what he longs for.
Hey, do you have time to hang around for a little bit while? We got to go to one last commercial break. Do you have time to hang around?
Go ahead. They may all call me to set here. I keep seeing them peek their head around the corner.
All right, whenever you're ready, whenever you got to go, you go. But we got to go to commercial, and we'll be right back here on Music Machete.
Love it.
Got a child that has too many questions or just won't shut the fuck up?
What?
Simple. Try our new child muzzle equipped with Zaptastic Child Safe Tasers, which are strategically placed at the back of the ears and temples. Comes with easy-to-open steel mouth zipper and free bendy straw. It's easy as 1, 2, 3. Go online, select all your children's sizes, sign our hold harmless, and submit payment. Enjoy every day without any annoying noise. Just the peaceful sounds of muffled bliss. Order now. Also available in pink vinyl and electric blue.
Get ready, get set, get Slope Cycle. The most innovative way to hit the hill this season is the exciting new Slope Cycle. The Slope Cycle is the most advanced way to conquer the slopes with no restraints, no straps, no restrictions. The Slope Cycle allows you to ride the mountain, and it's perfect to rock some tricks. It's as easy as snowboarding. Visit SlopeCycle.com for complete information and where to ride the next progression in winter sports. Slope Cycle! 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 Cycle!
Ever wanted to know how music really works? Revolutionary musical scientist and mathematician Alex Sioris is breaking new ground with his incredible new insights into music and the way the brain thinks. With colors, shapes, and numbers, Alex has been able to unlock the secrets of music that traditional music theory has shrouded in mystery for hundreds of years. Learn the secrets of chord theory, scales, and so much more in a simple musical circle. Now you can get a glimpse of ecometry in the form of an easy-to-use musical cookbook on your iPhone. Visit iTunes App Store now and do a search for Ecometry or visit ecometry.com. ECHOMETRY.com. Ecometry, because music theory is a convoluted bitch.
Need a new necklace? Go big. Big Bucks has got over 50 different styles. We also feature live raccoons to sport around the neighborhood and impress your friends with a rabbit-infested beast. Call today and we'll throw in the anaconda neck wrap and spider earrings just to complete the set. Get your unique style and become one with nature, you jackass.
And we're back on Music Machete. Hey, Gage, are you still on the line?
I am still here.
We still got Gage. Gage is on set right now. Gage, before they call you away, I want you to throw your websites back out there again because I want everybody to be able to get a hold of you who's been listening to you and be able to look up your stuff. So throw me your websites out there before they call you back to set.
That's good.
All right. Thank you so much. All right. So the first one is youtube.com/ The Gage Maverick. THEGAGE. M as in Mary. A, V as in Victor. E-R-I-K. The second one is Vimeo.com. Vimeo.com/ channels. That's plural. CHANNELS/ Gage TV. And the third one, I'm going to add a third one here. Go to Facebook.com. Facebook.com/ Gage TV Network. And check us out. Check out my online network called Gage TV. Certainly you can Google me at Gage Maverick. GAGEMAVERIK. And cool, amazing things come up. I appreciate you having me on the show, and I want to thank Troy for having me call in. Thank you so much, Troy. I look forward to working with you on many, many projects moving forward. And thank you for having me on the show today.
Yeah, thank you. It was great to have you on the show, Gage. We're going to listen to some music right now and kind of head out of here pretty quick here. We got another show coming up. But, Gage, I want to thank you. You get back there on that set and make that movie, man.
And I'm going to go make some magic for you, man. I'm going to think about you while we do it, and let's talk again, and let me know how I can hear the playback. I'd love to check this out.
For sure. We'll make sure you get a hold of the playback. All right. We'll talk to you later.
All right, guys. Enjoy, and keep tuning in, everybody. This guy's great. He's promoting great music, and he's doing great things. He's got a wonderful voice, too, by the way. So keep listening up, everybody. Keep tuning into the show every single week. Call in, call in, call often. See you guys. Gage Maverick out.
Take care, Maverick. All right. So there we go. Gage Maverick. Check him out. YouTube, Facebook, all over the web. Google him. You'll find him. Our number is 213-973-2977. You can call in if you like. We got about 10 minutes left. I pulled a bunch of music to listen to, and then Gage called. So we just kind of go with the flow here, and that's how we do it. It was fortunate, actually, tonight that we had the opportunity, the space open to do that. So I'm glad that he called. So let's check out. Let's see what we got on the playlist here. In the background right now, we got a little Dox. That's the name of it, D-O-X. Ties of the Bind. Let's check that out for a minute.
For the
maker. The bond that we both share is something that I savor. And whether we are young, mature to grow and old, it's still the test of time. It's something to behold. And though it's growing old, it's not getting old. I gaze upon your face and feel a rush of chemicals, a natural elevation, sensual sensations, renewing earthly bonds with heavenly relations. A natural elevation, sensual sensations, renewing earthly bonds with heavenly relations. A natural elevation, sensual sensations, renewing earthly bonds with heavenly relations.
Well, all right, there you go. That was Docs, Ties That Bind. Yeah, not too bad. We're going to see what we got up next here. This is Dream Team, Party After Party. Let's check this one out and see what we think.
And in my resume, we party with the best of play. So hand me a cup for the Dangeray. Kush in the air made a foggy day. Bitch, I'ma stick like a candy cane. It's live in the shows like it's New Year's Day. Stay only with the sexy dance, cause no one else can do the same. So, hey, come on, party with me every day. Hey, you can put it on your resume. Hey, no one else can ever do the same. Wow, wow, wow. Hey, come on, party with me every day. Hey, you can put it on your resume. Hey, no one else can ever do the same. We tryna do it right. Party every single day and night. Got a cup full of gin and juice if you want to have a good time. Just shake your body, girl. Rock it down, just rock my world. Flip it up and flip it out. Everybody knows what it's about. Hey, come on, party with me every day. Hey, you can put it on your resume. Hey, no one else can ever do the same. Hey, come on, party with me every day. Hey, you can put it on your resume. Hey, no one else can ever do the same.
Where my party people at? Let me hear you say, hey, 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 hey. Where my party people at? Let me hear you say, hey, 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 hey. Where my party people at? Let me hear you say, hey, 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 hey. Where my party people at? Let me hear you say, hey, 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 hey.
Passing my life so fast, I'm moving max. Music pumping, party packed, and this lifestyle is just my path. So I come to the game like an Anglo-Saxon. Follow me to the party smash. Hey, get my body with me every day. Hey, you can put it on your resume. Hey, no one else can ever do the same. Hey, get my body with me every day. Hey, you can put it on your resume. Hey, no one else can ever do the same.
I got the drinks up pouring, choo-choo like the smoke is blowing. I'm coming right through, Dream Team at my rendezvous. What you want, girl, what you need? Confidence color roll up my sleeve. Do you need it? Do you see it? Come on, baby girl, and beat it, beat it.
Hey, get my body with me every day. Hey, you can put it on your resume. Hey, no one else can ever do the same. Hey, get my body with me every day. Hey, you can put it on your resume. Hey, no one else can ever do the same.
Okay, I thought it was pretty cool up until this part. This is still the same song, Dream Team's Party After Party. I don't know about this part. I was like down with it. I'm like, yeah, this is kind of groovy. This is kind of chill. But I don't know. There's still 55 seconds left, and they just got annoying kind of right there at the end. So Dream Team might... Yeah, I don't know where you're going with this. I don't know. I don't know. You just lost me in that last part. I'm sure this is a really interesting ending. Let's see. Is it? No, it's not. Iterate. So I'm all for experimenting, but I don't know. Sometimes I gotta wonder about these people. You people are strange, you people. So, next song we got is Drew Ryan, Love Gone Bad. Let's hope it's something good. Anybody who listens to my other shows will know that I love jam bands. So Drew Ryan rocked it out, in my opinion. We got just enough time to let this song play. Actually, we don't. You know, we don't even want this song. I can already tell you it's not going to be good. Let's check this out. This is Devon, Girl of Mine. And y'all have a good one. And yeah, there you go. This was Music Machete.
And she says, wasting time, oh, I need your touch. And then she calls out, hold me all through the winter. And then she calls out, love me, hold me and love me all summer long. Over. Kiss me, kiss me, it's through.
we have to punish your awful... Can we even call that music? Join us again next week for more cat torture to inject and defecate. Stay tuned for something listenable. American Psycho coming up next on Excite Radio.